policy-making, the locus of your policy should be shifted. So when that is the context, that is the neoliberal context, we are talking about decentralization. See, this, the problem is market is centralized, monopolization of the economic resources, right? A huge multinational corporation with such a huge resources. Now, when your economy is getting centralized and the decision-making as far as economic activity is concerned, you know, is getting centralized not only at the local level but global level, and US, we have seen how powerful it has become. It's something like, you know, the United States of America, and I don't want to say Urdu University because, you know, somebody if the press all our rights, you know, they may misunderstand you, but it's something like a global gunda. See, they do everything. They do everything. They have a nuclear weapon, you know, they can go to Iraq, they can do anything. But if you want to have a nuclear weapon, they say, you should not have. I just don't understand, who is he to tell us not to have when he has? This centralization of power, centralization of information, centralization of resources, centralization of capital, centralization of technology, with the result that today the power structure, power is substantive power is not even with us. We are not realizing that the real power is not even locus of the power here. And when I went to negotiate for the two abductions of the district collector, both in Chhattisgarh and Orissa, what is the problem? Tribals are saying, sir, they are coming and occupying the mines, they are mining, but we are not even rehabilitated. They are asking us to just get out. Why would we go? अरे आपका पिक पॉकेट होए तो अर्बन एरिया में बस में वो भाग के मारते हैं पिक पॉकेट होए तो उसको तो घर झोपड़ी जो है तो चलो जाओ वेयर विल ही गो दे आर फाइटिंग सो आई आस्क बोथ द चीफ मिनिस्टर्स व्हाई डोंट यू अकोमोडेट व्हाई डोंट यू रिहैबिलिटेट द ट्राइबल बिफोर यू टेक अवे द रिसोर्सेस दे से दे हैव नो आंसर दे से यस यस वी वांट टू वी हैव दैट लॉ वी हैव दिस लॉ फॉरेस्ट राइट्स एक्ट एंड ऑल दैट बट the helplessness of the chief ministers also, that they do not have the real power to tell the World Bank, get out, no, we will not allow you to come. Or they are not having that power to tell the mining lab, you know, the mineral resources, those who are mining, they don't have that power to tell them that you can't mine, you can't, you know, adversely, you know, I mean, impact on the tribals of, you know, the poor tribals, no. And they're very innocent, but they are also, I mean, decent people. I mean, they're very fascinating people. They live their own simple, you know, life. So I think this is one problem that you have, that I think when we take up the urban studies, we should address when the nature of the political economy, when the power is getting global, centralized, how do we manage the urban affairs with a decentralized, you know, self-governance, good governance, I think is one challenge that we have. As a part of the neoliberal model, I would say, if you read Stiglitz's, no, globalization and discontent is all his 5-6 works. Recently, he was in University of Hyderabad. We had a dinner with him. And what Stiglitz says is that finally, his solution to the problem of America, because he was advisor to American president and he was in the World Bank, he says unless America reduces its levels of consumption, there is no solution to American crisis. They have to come down and live with lesser consumption, right? That is the only lasting solution to American crisis. Because the levels of consumption of United States of America, long back, an American child consumes 32 times more resources than an Indian child. So whenever I talk to the demographers and, you know, these people, population wallahs, I always tell them, how do you count population? You go by the head count. या हमारा गरीब बच्चा जो है उसका तो कुछ दूध पी रहा वो जी रहा अमेरिकन बच्चा तो बहुत ज्यादा खा रहा और इफ पॉपुलेशन इज मोर यू ओनली इन टर्म्स ऑफ नेचुरल रिसोर्सेस ना व्हेन डू यू कॉल ओवर पॉपुलेटेड बिकॉज योर रिसोर्सेस कैन नॉट सस्टेन देम इट्स नॉट अ सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट इफ दैट इज सो इफ वन अमेरिकन चाइल्ड इज बॉर्न इज इक्वल टू 32 चिल्ड्रन बॉर्न इन इंडिया इन टर्म्स ऑफ कंजम्पशन Now, American population is maybe, you know, 25-30 crore, but if you take the consumption levels, right, consumption levels of the American population, it comes 750 crores in terms of the consumption. Now, that consumption which they are encouraging, they are also encouraging rest of the world to go for higher levels of consumption. Car, you know, I mean, any communication, food, I mean, you have variety of food. Hyderabad to itna badal gaya ki when I came to Hyderabad in 1960 as a very innocent rural boy, the Hyderabad, it was a city of bicycles. You know, we used to have bicycle. And you know, that days, you know, for bicycle you should have a kandil, a small kerosene lamp. Usko pakde to, you know, there is a problem that the police station ko the cycle will be taken. Then you have to go to the court, appear before a judge that why you have, you know, I mean, run your bicycle on a wrong road or left side, the right side. And then the judge will fine. You have to go to the bank, pay challan and bring your bicycle. My God, that was a terrible thing. But that was the situation in Hyderabad because bicycle was such an important vehicle. Now, from that city of bicycles, now we really don't know what happened to Hyderabad. Right? And the whole Hyderabad city, now pollution, cars, I mean, this is something, you know, happening. Now, if you provide extremely good public transport, Delhi, in fact, I think, sir, you have seen that in Delhi after the metro, in fact, the things have slightly improved because a lot of population pushed down. And, you know, a lot of pressure has come down on the road. Now, if you provide an extremely good public transport, I think hardly anybody will be willing to go by car. In Europe, people prefer a train. You know, they don't drive this. Driving car in Hyderabad, you go mad. So instead, you provide good public transport. Then what will happen to the automobile companies? And automobile company is not your company. Although India also produces a couple of cars, but we are not producers of vehicles. No? And the car company... See, why our salaries have been raised in the fifth pay commission? There was an automobile lobby sitting on the UGC throat. Every teacher should be a potential. Now, the next pay commission, every school teacher will have a car. See, this is the, you know, way that they are moving. Small market, but everybody will have high levels of consumption. Urban people are consuming today so much that compared to rural area, I go to my village, my brother stays there with his two children. My God, my brother's standard of living and our standard is absolutely no comparison. No comparison. That boy is living such a modest life. And what happened to agriculture? The total share of agriculture in the GDP, when I was a student of agricultural economics in way back in my BA, the total share of agriculture was 66% in the GDP. Today, 13.5%. 13.5%. 20 industrial houses are controlling 22% of GDP. 60 crores people are living on 13.5% of GDP. Yesterday, Ravindra Prasad talked about the, I saw in the press, that expansion, urbanization. He said that there will be faster urbanization, you know, massive urbanization. Yes. But where is that urbanization coming from? Urbanization is coming because the share of agriculture, if it declines from 60% to 13.5%, pauperization is inevitable. 2.5 lakh farmers committed suicide. That is the price we have paid for marginalization of agriculture. Then population is moving from the villages to the urban areas in search of livelihood. Therefore, you have slums, crime, pavement dwellers, beggars, you know, with rags and all that. Now, you have the urban scenario. Yeah, that the entire rural, you know, people, they are shifting to urban areas. Whereas China has taken care of that. China, what it has done, it has completely went for radical land reform. Every family has been given a bit of land. If they even come to Beijing, they can. If they don't find anything, they can go back. There's something to fall back, at least in the village. But here, if I don't have any resource in the, you know, in the village, I come searching the job to district headquarters, then I come to land in Hyderabad. Where will I go from Hyderabad now? Either I have to go to Delhi, or I have to stay in Hyderabad. Whether the pavement, whether the slum, whether the drainage water, or whether it's the prostitution. Hyderabad, you can't imagine. Hyderabad city, I feel shocked. 11 o'clock, 11:30, if you know, I come from my civil liberties for sometime late nights, the way the prostitution has gone up. And the near Gauliguda bus stop, my sister-in-law stays, if a young couple, newly married agriculture labor couple, come in search of a job, there are gundas waiting near bus stand, and they pick up that girl, put her in auto and take away. And every day my sister-in-law says, it is horrible for me to watch because husband runs after the auto crying and all that. He doesn't know Hyderabad city, he doesn't know anybody. What happened to the urban, you know, civilization? What happened to that? Then I went to the commissioner because he is a student of mine. I told the commissioner that you put complete surveillance on the bus stand. And put such a watch that, you see, this is something I can't take. As a citizen of Hyderabad, there's a, you know, I mean, I can't take it. But then, this entire crime, see, poor people, innocent people coming to Hyderabad in search of a livelihood, not knowing what is this urban, you know, jungle. Right? Now you are pushing people into the urban areas instead of providing various checks. Look at Japan. entire spare parts of an automobile or any industry are produced in the local area, and they are then assembled. Either you decentralize your industrial production processes or give certain decent life to the people at different levels so that the urban pressure comes down. There is no way. Chidambaram says by 2040 we will have 80% urban population. If you have 80% urban population, what are you going to do with them? Where are you going to absorb them? America, yes, because their population, and if you look at the continent, so in America, there are 3% agricultural population, and 3% GDP of the nation. It's all right. Only 3% of American people are in agriculture. Can you do that in India? If you have 3% of the people, if 100 crores of the people move to the urban areas, can these urban areas sustain? Take Hyderabad City. When Hyderabad City was launched, the king said that my city should have, like a sea full of fish. My city should have full of human beings. Because there are so few human beings that his dream was full of human beings. But yes, today is the full of human beings. I don't think he ever even imagined that 1 crore people will live in Hyderabad. This is not meant for that. This city is meant for 5 lakhs people. Their road, their drainage system, their water. Water is at least, we had huge tanks, 40 tanks. I mean, at least water, 440 tanks in Hyderabad. Now, Justice Sudarshan Reddy, who just retired from Supreme Court, now, of course, he became Lokayukta. Ever since he retired from Supreme Court, in Telangana meetings, he is asking only one question: what happened to 440 tanks of Hyderabad? What happened to gardens? Now, in other words, this urban civilization is moving into a situation where you do not have breathing space. There's no lung space. So when, in fact, Urdu University wanted land in Hyderabad University, because Hyderabad University has huge land, the minister, Bommai, and all of them came. I was one of the person negotiating on behalf of the university. Education secretary came, and our vice chancellor, Gordhan Mehta, was there. Gordhan Mehta said, sir, please don't take away the land, because, you see, this is only the lung space for the city. If you completely barter your land and you go on, reducing even University of Hyderabad land, environmentally, Hyderabad will become unsustainable. Then Bommai saw a point. Then later in the lunch, he said that I see a point in what your vice chancellor is saying, but we have to search for some land. Of course, we also thought two campuses on the same, university will also look a little odd. One university, competing or being compared. But the point is that they do not want any empty space in Hyderabad. Everywhere there is an occupation. Now, there is not even a moving space in Hyderabad. Pavement dweller, imagine there are no pavements in Hyderabad. I think Vice Chancellor must have found it very strange that there is no walking space on the road. I mean, we have completely removed the pavements. No city, no civilized city in the world will not have a place for a walker, for a pedestrian. That's what Narayanan, K.R. Narayanan said, that while at the crossroads, please remember the pedestrian. Please remember that was the Republic Day address. So I think the neoliberal model, the way it's encouraging the consumption, and levels of consumption have gone up so much that urban areas have become so overburdened with the population, and the resources are falling short. The only way is the development itself has to be decentralized. You have to provide this village, this town. See, you look at US. You go to any US small, I lived in 13 American families. Every village has almost all urban facilities. Now, it looks an urban area. I mean, it doesn't look different. Now, either you have to develop in such a manner, a villager has all the access to the facilities that urban people enjoy, and gradually you have to extend these facilities. Instead of bringing labor to Hyderabad, you have to take development to the people. Then Hyderabad city will become a little more sustainable. Otherwise, given the present level of consumption and the neoliberal model of vision of development, I am sure that we are in for a major disaster. Is there going to major crime? What will be the nature of the crisis? Crime? Murders? Right? Robbery? The servants, killing the, landlord, the landlady? This is what happened in the Philippines, if you see the, shock doctrine of Niami, she's depicting what happened to the urban spaces in the various other countries who have urbanized beyond what is sustainable. I think my own feeling is that I think centers for urban studies, seminars on urban studies, I'm sure will also have to address these larger questions of power, structure of power, model of development, and rural-urban imbalances, and then give a model of development which becomes sustainable as at a national level. It's not merely one city sustainable, but these larger questions can be raised only in universities. Planning commission completely gone. Policy making, you know, IAS officer, no, they have their own, you know, I mean, narrow vision or whatever you call. Where will be bold ideas, no? Where will you raise questions of the next generation? Where will you raise the questions which are very fundamental to the society? Except universities, I do not see any place where some of these questions can be raised. And I'll stop. When I suggested a Center for Human Rights for University of Hyderabad, for my own teacher was the chairman, University Grants Commission. And but the UGC bureaucracy said, oh, human rights very sensitive hai, human rights, no, it will raise number of questions, Haragopal ka reputation, thoda activist reputation, all sorts of questions the UGC started debating. So one of the joint secretary wrote on the file, the human rights area being very sensitive, giving this program to University of Hyderabad may create some problem. Then Professor Amreddy wrote on the file, if inconvenient questions cannot be raised in the university, where else they can be raised? And he returned the file. And then he said, we have to debate. However, inconvenient the question is, university has to debate. I think urban challenge, in that sense, the seminar is a very timely seminar. And I think some of these concerns have been raised here. But if Urdu University is looking forward to address the question, you know, of these urban areas, and particularly, I would say, I mean, minorities in the urban areas, marginalization of the people, and, you know, communalization, and the violence we have seen of the Gujarat kind, you know, these are all not that, you know, past story. This is going to be the future story of, you know, of India. It's very alarming. I mean, sometimes you don't get sleep if you think about the magnitude of the problem. But at the same time, I think we have to negotiate with this situation, and I am sure that a creative application of a university freedom for the larger questions of the society, I am sure that this seminar is a very, you know, rewarding experience, and I am thankful to you for inviting me to give this valedictory address. While I, instead of making concluding remarks, I raised the questions, because ultimately a function of a seminar either to clarify or to confuse. One of the two things should happen, because either participant should go more with clarity or more confused. But he should not go intact. You know, every seminar should do that. Either it clarifies or confuses. I don't know whether I have added to clarification or confusion. But I think that the valedictory address is meant for that. I hope that I have done a part of the damage, whatever I could do. But that you have to, Rahmatullah, you should be blamed if I have done some damage to whatever thought you had last 2 days. But I thank you very much for this.